Loana, he won the Corita Kala Ledesma Award and also the Metrobank Artificers Award this year and last year for Cameo. Sam Marcelo, editor of Business World, Highlight, associate editor of Business World Highlight. And John Oliveira, he's the editor-in-chief of Discurso.com. It's a website and a Facebook page for for discussion with art criticism online. Mr. Cidreyes, of course, needs no introduction. He will be moderating this panel. So it is presentations. We each have presentations. So I guess I'll give it to Sir Cid.
Okay, I'm very honored to have been asked to be moderator for the presentation of this. Three young critics. I say this because of a certain perspective. Again, there was a time when I was as young as Carlo Mar here. Okay, and brings back happy memories. And at the same time, it shows you the continuation of the generation, in effect. I'm so relieved is the word, gratified that younger generation of art writers and art critics are taking over, and it's about time. It's about time. I wish that we had more of them. So, having said my personal elation at being with the young critics now, we will give the floor to each of them as each makes his or her own presentation. First one is presented by Mr. Carlo Mar. Okay, a big hand for Mr. Carlo Mar.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us in this very new afternoon. And Carlo Mar, I'm one of the columnists of the Philippine Star. That route was introduced by my winning the Kuntahala Lesma, Art Criticism Prize, because that was the prize for you to write a one-year column for the Philippine Star. So I think, given that it started last year, the partners, Corita Kala Ledesma Foundation, Ateneo Art Awards, and of course, the Philippine Star, and vision for something like that to continue. So expect that in the 10-year time, there will be presumably 10 critics already writing for the art section of the Philippines. So my role here is to ask questions or to raise questions on how the space for the visual arts can be further expanded when it comes to, say, particularly broadsheet. Which what I represent. Okay, broad strokes, the role of Philippine Star in general. It has always provided an extensive coverage of the visual arts. If you check out our pages, sometimes the pages range from 4, if we're lucky, 8, every week on Monday. A considerable portion of that space is devoted to the visual arts. Okay, so out of the 64 I-9 articles, meaning written by a columnist or a staff writer, published in the last 3 months, August 17 to October 17, 30 were features on artists and or their artworks. So after that, this number is more than that of other art forms such as literature, theater, music, film, and dance. So as you can see, we have far more coverage on visual arts than say literature. And considering that Prip Yuson and Bush Devisai are there as columnists. Out of the 13 features, only 5 were strictly exhibition reviews. So some may be profiles, but out of the 13 articles published on the visual arts, 5 towards strictly exhibition reviews. I know the number is not encouraging because in 3 month time, there will be about, I don't know, how many openings. There are about at least 30 galleries now, which would have, at the Metro Manila, which would have like a monthly exhibition. So 5 doesn't pretty much represent the activity and the energy going on in the production and the exhibition of visual arts. So why so few art reviews? First, of course, we have to talk about space. The newspaper is what? How many centuries ago? Still based on the printed page, the real estate of the page, so to speak. So you can only put in as many articles as possible, as the space would allow. So space, that would be the main consideration. I think I'm speaking not just in behalf of like Philippine Star, but like generally, even the broadsheets in the States, in the UK, for instance, artists have been complaining that the space for them is dwindling in terms of like coverage and all of that. So there are market forces, definitely. Perhaps advertisers are moving towards social media and online. So that, but Philippine Star naman has always been consistently having at least a fold, meaning a four page. Part of the art section every Monday. So that's really reserved for that. And as you know, art coverages don't generate like advertising. So I don't know, I won't say that it's like, I'm not in a position to speak that it's like their, what do you call that, like their the conscience of the newspaper, whatever, but so good to have something like that happening at least every Monday. And then there's also the issue of audience. This is really more like an editorial decision. So for instance, the decision would be between a film festival as opposed to an art exhibition. Since we're talking about limitation of space, then definitely the film festival would take precedence. Not because it's more important, but because it caters to a broader audience. And film festivals happen like for weeks. Like an unlimited period of time. That's why we also want to publish it as like exhibitions last for a month, and then we would hope to make it. Okay, so yeah, but I need a feature to this week, possibly next week, and then again the issue of space, and then it ends. Of course, there's no marching order for us not to write about exhibitions that have already ended, but editorially speaking, that doesn't make any sense anymore because there are other exhibitions, emerging in the wake of the exhibitions that were already ended and all of that. And also, the practitioners also, in terms of those writing about art, those who have committed their energy and their focus on writing about the visual arts. I would say like during the like from the late 90s to the mid 2000s even, I would say it was very robust with the presence of like Ana Labrador, Sir Ruben, Richie Lerma having regular columns for the Philippine Star. So they were part. And Sir Sid is also one of our columnists. They took on other paths. That's why those who are really known for critiquing art, they're not, I would say, not as active, but have chosen other paths other than, you know, commenting on the the temperature of contemporary art. Okay, so more like that. But how is this being addressed? Of course, there's that issue, we're very aware of that. So how does the newspaper address that? Focuses on information dissemination, such as in the section Gallery News, that lists upcoming exhibition. So this is one of the non-negotiables in our paper, that we have like a half page devoted to the exhibitions that are that will be on view, or are on view, could be also. So regardless what gallery you are, you may be somewhere in the regions, or you're one of the top galleries here in Metro Manila, we'll make sure that we can publish your announcement. At least people will have an awareness about the institutions and the artists that you're featuring. So I won't say that's the most that we can do, but that's possibly the most democratic way for an art gallery to have a representation in the newspaper. So that, and also the Purita Kala Ledesma Prize for Art Criticism. As you know, it was established last year, and the prize, as I mentioned earlier, was bi-monthly column, so twice a month. So far, based on my meager computation, I've written about, I would say, 30 plus columns. Based on that, they've extended my tenure, so to speak. I'll still continue writing exhibitions and visual arts. Although as part of my role also as a columnist, I'm also assigned events to write. So it's not like this is what I want to write, but because of course there are certain editorial requirements, and I'm pretty much aware of that. So I also cover other non-visual arts, particularly coverages. So there's a new winner. Her name is Paola Acuin. She worked for MCAD, the Contemporary Art and Design Museum, at St. Pinil, College of St. Pinil, College of La Salle. So she'll be writing, and as you can see, she'll be more into really the contemporary stuff, like the cutting edge, the non-painting, the installation art, and all of that. Because admittedly, my bias leans towards more on the painting, more on the figurative. So possibly traditional, but that's what, as a viewer, I respond to. So of course, I will write about genres that first I'm familiar with, because of course I would read books and all of that, and that I'm constantly exposed to. But Paola Acuin will give that different flavor to arts and culture. And so she, arts and culture section, and so she will also have that twice a month column, so which will start soon, because she was proclaimed early last month. So veteran arts and culture columnists write occasionally about visual arts as well. So I mentioned our regular columnists would be of course Kirk Nguyen, Butch Delisay, there's also Nia Arcelana and Tondre Motto, and occasionally Sir Stitt here. Despite the fact that they're more connected to like same picture, like the first four mentioned, the first four names that I mentioned earlier, they also write about art, which is I think when they were like in their like 20s, 30s and all of that, they would hang out like with visual arts. And I long for that day that writers, critics, literary practitioners who would like assimilate more with the visual arts community. So, you know, dialogues can happen and all of that. But in the 60s, 70s, they just happened naturally. They would hang out, say, at Ingles Bravos, at in Bermuda, and all of that. So these are the Dan Cab and Griff Hewson. That's why, for instance, Griff Hewson would be the natural choice to write about the work of Bob Dan Cab, because, you know, he's familiar with the work. He has access to him, can ask him any questions possible, so something like that. So in that sense, there's more of a community. I can't say that there's one like that right now. Although, of course, I also have like visual artist friends, but yeah. So I don't write about them in my column, which is a pity for them, right? But I would write like their exhibition notes and all of that. So one of the guidelines of the award is that if you write the exhibition note or something like that, then you are prohibited from making it in your column, because you know, check it, the there's a line that doesn't have to be crossed. So like if there are what about this gallery managers or gallery owners here, like the question is, because we're talking about the audience encountering art really through the spaces, the gallery space, what's happening, the pulse of contemporary art transpires in the spaces, so it's important really to pay attention to what they're doing. So how can they broaden the coverage, push it some more, so to speak? Conduct artist talks and exhibition walkthroughs that art writers may cover and allow them to engage with artists beyond the exhibition opening, because sometimes the main event would be the exhibition opening and then that's it. But if a gallery, which would say have like a one month run for one artist, for one exhibition, perhaps you could insert like an artist talk or an exhibition walkthrough that's open to the public as well, so that we can write on that, we can cover that, we can feature that. That's what to call that. That's a possible coverage for us, not just for like STAR, but for others. Like if you invite them, hopefully they will come. So pitch STAR ideas to editors. Like write them a letter. I did in the States, it is more apparent, especially through their publicity fears, but in the Philippines, that's okay to, like, if you want your artist to be interviewed, you want an award, but something happened to his life, you know, like a milestone, or like after something, after like a considerable number of time, then he comes back and the artist scene with his exhibition. Pitch that idea more, but because the chances are it might be responded to and get covered. And strengthen online presence, because of course there are so many galleries now, and sometimes the process of, you know, selecting what exhibition to review would be, you know, like a cursory glimpse on the different websites of the different galleries. So if there's something that takes, for instance, my attention, perhaps I will write about that, something like that. So that's important as well. So I know at the get-go what I'll be writing about, rather than, what do you call that, guessing or willy-nilly just dropping by and then checking out the exhibition. At least I would be guided with a kind of curatorial take, with a kind of course, the artworks that will be exhibited. And if something that I feel I'm competent enough to take on, then I'll check it out, something like that. So, ultimately, just put out great shows. Because that will be romantic as a term maybe, but that's your form, the best form of affirmation that you can get. More than the publicity, more than the politicians that you will generate, that will be, I think, the reward. Just put out a great show. And in that sense also, we will be able to live. If it defeats us, challenges us, or interests us, then that's something that will definitely be soon. That's all, thank you.
Is it okay if I stand up? Thank you, Duffy, for organizing this. Sid for moderating. The honor is all ours. And Carlo, thank you for setting up my talk beautifully because you gave a sort of macro view of, you know, broadsheet, mass media. The first thing I want to tell you guys is that I am not a critic. I do not think of myself as a critic. I am a reporter. I'm a journalist. Okay? And I write for Business World. Well, I used to write for Business World. I'm now with a magazine. It's complicated. So let's just say I write for a newspaper, and it's a business paper. It is not an art newspaper. So this is a paper that talks to people who are not as comfortable with the kind of language that critics like the panelists in the first talk speak fluently, okay? So I will back, wait, no, hold on. Can you go back? Yeah. Let's go back to 2011, 4 years ago, when art found itself on the front page of major dailies. It was on television shows, it was on talk radio, and it was a time when everyone, from Pinoy to your hairdresser to the person sitting beside you, probably had an opinion about a single show. Okay? Yes, we can now go to the next slide. And of course, you know that this show is Kulo, which ran from June 17 to 2011 to August 9, 2011. It closed a couple of weeks early in the main gallery of the Cultural Center of the Philippines. Now, this was a group exhibition that featured 32 artists. Keep that in mind, 32 artists, okay? Next slide, please. But all of the talk generated by this exhibition centered on this work by Mr. Medeo Cruz. The title of this work was called An Eastman. Okay, I was the arts and culture reporter for Business World when this blew up. It started July 18, I think, when a television show aired a segment and somehow related this piece to the reproductive health bill, which was a very hot and controversial topic at that time. Okay, next slide, please. And then coverage continued. This is a quote from Archbishop Oscar Cruz. He said, and was quoted saying that politeismo is not only sick, it is also sickening. He implied that Medeo Cruz, the artist, was abnormal, okay, and that he had to see a psychiatrist. These reports, the initial reports, were like pretty one-sided and didn't actually take the time to get the side of Mr. Cruz, okay? It also misrepresented Kulo in that it made it seem like the exhibition was just this one work, or that there was just this giant dig in the CCP and that was it. But that was not the case, okay? Next slide, please. Can you just allow me to go off tangent and put this question to the floor? How is Archbishop Cruz like Barbara Streisand? Can anyone fathom a guess? Would anyone like to take a stab at this question? Yes. No. Sorry. Good try, but no. Okay, next slide, please. Something called the Streisand effect, okay? Let me quote Wikipedia. Thank you, Wikipedia, for this definition. The Streisand effect is a phenomenon whereby an attempt to censor something leads to great interest in the story or work that nobody would have noticed had they not attempted to ban or censor it in the first place. In Barbara Streisand's case, that something was her Malibu beach house. Okay, a real estate developer, I think, posted a picture of it, and she was like, get it off your side. There was legal stuff, lawsuits, whatever, and so every news outlet picked up the picture of her beach house and started posting it everywhere. Same thing, sort of, with Archbishop Cruz's statements. It was picked up. So somehow, we have to thank him, thank you, Archbishop Cruz, for all the attention that was placed on art at that time. Next slide, please. This is a photo I took of Karen Flores during a press conference held here in UB. Everyone had something to say about this exhibition. Jingoy Estrada called for the resignation of everyone on the CCP board, okay? And he said something like, these ugly, insulting, blasphemous images achieve nothing, enrich no one, and debase instead of uplift. Senate President Juan Ponce Enriquez supported Mr. Estrada's call. Senate Majority Leader Lupita Soto III threatened to slash the CCP's budget. Okay, so there were a lot of things flying around. Next slide, please. Okay, I'm sorry you can't see it, but this is like a screenshot of Google Trends I took during that time. So I actually had to go back to my archive, to my notes, for this talk, and I'm glad that I still have these things. So from August 6th to August 11th, there were 100 articles citing Kulo. Okay, 100. That's a lot for one show. As Carlo mentioned earlier, I mean, like how many in a month? I forget, but this many, okay? International news organizations such as Fox News, CBS, BBC News, The Washington Post, Forbes, The Huffington Post, picked up the Kulo story from the Associated Press, a wire service. And it was everywhere thanks to Imelda Marcos, who is still a person of interest. She went to CCP. Sorry. One moment, please. Imelda went to CCP, she had a TV crew with her, if memory serves, okay? So she called for the closure of the exhibition and said it was ugly in front of cameras. Kulo landed on the front page of Philippine Star. Thank you. Yeah, for doing that. The New York Times also. The New York Times, can you believe it? Ran a story on Kulo on page 812, okay? So Reuters, Wall Street Journal, those guys also picked up the story. My point is, this was huge. Next slide, please. These are the names of all the columnists who had something to say about Kulo. At least this is from like a cursory Google search from a Deadline Harried reporter on the day before she had to submit the story, okay? Because we collated all the opinions and actually ran tidbits just to gauge what people were saying, okay? So art was given column inches by newspapers as pundits weighed in on artistic freedom, on blasphemy, on sacrilege, sometimes multiple times, okay? This is just a sampling. This list is just a sampling from August 4, 2011 to August 18, 2011. And it's interesting to note, if you look at the names there, they're not, like say for a few, they're not mainly art guys, okay? Like where were the names of the panelists, the first talk? I wish they were there. I wish they were the ones being given space. I wish they were the ones somehow influencing the discourse. But it's great that people were talking about it. We'll take what we can get, you know? Also, it was Bien Lumbera, I think, and Ernest Jose were quite vocal. They are national artists, yes, natural artists for literature. I wish the art guides were talking, you know, yeah. So where was the conversation within the community taking place? This is a question I would like to throw later. Like, was it happening in academic circles? I don't know where it was happening. Why didn't we reach out to the broader public? Clearly, people wanted thoughts on this matter. I mean, we published stuff from Karen Flores and the curator of the exhibition, Jay Paseda, and I'm pretty sure that if someone with a voice in the community gave us a piece, we would gladly have published it. Next slide, please. Okay, this is F. Sunil Hossain, his column in the Philippine Star. So this is what he said. Kulo is not, I repeat, it is not art. It is an immature and juvenile attempt at caricature. I have not seen the exhibit itself, but I have seen pictures of it, and they are enough to convince me of the validity of my conclusion. Emphasis is mine, okay? As Shamila says, not an isolated case. Many other pundits confess to not having seen the exhibition, and that is their right, you know? It's actually Shamil Hossain, for crying out loud. I'm not going to question Shamil Hossain. And he knows his stuff. I mean, he had a gallery at one point, right? He did, yeah. So he knows what he's talking about. But still, remember, yeah. Okay, so thank you. Let's go to the next slide. This is the payoff of my talk. This is the point that I want to make. Okay, and I turn you to Rachel Maddow, who is with, I forget what network in the States. MSNBC, thank you, Carlo. Okay, she said this when she was on the Howard Stern show. Okay, so let me read out this very nice quote to you. So there have to be reporters, there have to be full-time editors. It's got to be a professional gig. Otherwise, the rest of us who bloviate for a living are not going to have any facts on which to base our bloviation. Okay, so next slide, please. This is, like, may I humbly present this little diagram here. I really think that criticism has to be supported by reportage. You have to know what's out there, what's on. There is space for both Dr. Flores, who said, I think, Kanina, that you don't want people who rely on reportorial kinds of pieces. I think there is space for both, because not everyone is at that level yet where they can get crit right away, you know? Let's take baby steps. Okay, next slide, please. So this is the ladder of abstraction. Before we climb the ladder of abstraction and talk about artistic freedom, about blasphemy, about sacrilege, about good art, bad art, gesture, all your isms, all of the things that you have learned in your art classes, let's get the basics right first. You have to get the 5 W's and the 1 H, right, at the very least, okay? Good reportage is done best with your boots and with your ears. You go there and you actually talk to the people involved, you listen to them, and you get their side, okay? So, next slide, please. Do I still have time? This is the part where I toot my own horn, and I apologize. Next slide, please. Okay, here. The first piece I wrote was published in Business World, July 29. Remember that graph I showed you a while ago? Remember how it started August 4? Well, this was before that. So for this piece, I spoke with Karen Flores. I spoke with, like, via, I think it was via text, I think, with or email with Medeo. I talked to JPAC, the curator. And so I think it was a pretty good story. It's pretty solid. And it also went back to the other exhibitions that were mounted in the CCP that Karen Flores said were even more controversial than Kulo. Business World also got its hand on memos sent by Mr. Sumiko, so on and so forth. anyway, the point is, only when you have solid art reportage can you have accessible art criticism. You have to know what these critics are talking about, right? And also, in my role as associate editor of High Life magazine, I have actually asked Dr. Patrick Flores, Sid Reyes, Ms. Boots Herrera, to write stories for me because I'm interested in what they have to say. Okay, so now I think it's great that I have a platform to share with them. Okay, so next slide please, and this is the last slide. What is our role? Our role is to care enough to get the story right. And that's it. So questions, I guess, will be for later.
Okay, after that, the funny thing, treatment on the politics and aesthetics surrounding our genitalia. Let me bore you with my talk, which I'm going to read because I'm not so used to contemporaneous. So this is the title of my talk, Blind and Deaf Men Around an Elephant, on the role of writers, editors, publishers, and the art community in the formation of a living art critical culture. Okay, what is the state of art criticism in the country today? Are there truly problems facing art criticism in the Philippines? What is the role of a new art magazine's editor or publisher in addressing these problems? These are the questions I am supposed to ask myself and provide answers to in my talk today, so here are my answers. As an editor of an art magazine online, busy with providing fragments of art criticism, I consider myself a player rather than an observer from without, and cannot therefore make a competent assessment of the state of art criticism in our country as seen from a distance or from above, if only because I would neither have the time to do that, nor is it my job to do that. For the same reasons, I would also not be suitable as going to give you an enumeration of the problems facing art criticism today. But I can give you situations as I observe them from the position where I stand. You may judge for yourselves whether these observations may function as anecdotal evidence for your final judgment on the idea of an overall current state of Philippine art criticism. Let me start by saying that from where I stand, the state of art criticism in the country seems to be doing fine, although also not fine. Now, to explain that dual view, let me go to the introduction to the Facebook page on this revulsion, Critical Platforms, which stated the following. It is often pointed out that in the midst of all the present growth in the Philippine art industry, criticism in visual art has largely stagnated. There are relatively few active art writers and critics, and even fewer platforms for their works. Italics are mine. This leaves the market as practically the sole form of validation for an artistic practice and for its subsequent place in art history. Now, we all agree on the reality of that growth in the art industry, the auctions, the art fairs, but when we say there's stagnation due to a poverty of art criticism, we'll be faced with the problem of a definition of that phrase, art criticism, as well as the problem of validating a statistical statement that uses the words few or lacking. First of all, why do we seek more writers and writing? What do we want to happen? Is it because we want the Philippine art community to have a living art critical culture? But what do we mean by that? A living art critical culture. What are we looking for? Are we looking for lively and loud and prejudiced critics like the late Brian Sewell, so we can declare our art critical culture to be buhay na buhay? And when we say art criticism, do we mean solely art criticism established by there having been printed as books or journal essays, or established by their presence as broad essays or as art reviews in magazines or newspapers we know? why don't we include curatorial right wing too, which also contain critical thoughts? Why not include PR right wing for shows that galleries provide, which also contain critical thoughts or claims? Why not include what artists say about their art and others' art during interviews? Why not include comments on Facebook that may be valid as art critical statements? Because if we can be liberal about it and include all of these as among our art criticism sources, then maybe we can discard that statistical statement of ours that says we only have a few active art writing and criticism. In fact, if you give me 48 hours, it's possible that I'll be able to gather at least 50 art critical writings that were produced from these sources in the past 2 months and put all those materials on the table in front of you as evidence of Philippine writing and arts being not so few. So I believe we have enough art writing going on. But if I believe we have enough art writing going on in all the various places, where is it that I would deem us to be not okay? Lately, I have been tagged on Facebook as a theorist. It may be embarrassing for me to accept that tag, but let me try to live up to that tag just for today, because I have a theory. I have a theory that our problem is not in the number of art reviews that are put out there, or in the number of art critical statements that are commented on Las Patilis, Art Philippines, or elsewhere in Facebook. I think our problem is in our obsession with the notion that we are shorthanded in our art critical efforts. Everywhere I go, people tell me about art classes and discursos and any other art writing outlets being important to the art industry because the industry is in dire need of art criticism. There are only a few people doing it. This is actually a lie. Because first of all, isn't everybody a critic? Isn't the only difference between a music CD buyer and the professional music critic in the fact that the professional critic can articulate what may actually be impressions already in the mind of the buyer? And in the absence of the articulate critic, wouldn't the inarticulate critic statements pass for criticism too? Now, medyo lalayo nga lang tayo masyado pag lumalim tayo sa issue na yan. So let me now talk about Al Dubb. The reason why Al Dubb became such a living part of Philippine pop culture was not because somebody came up with the idea and implemented it. You could actually have 100 new fine shows in all the local channels in the archipelago, all of them with an Al Dubb sort of concept. But if nobody is going to react to any of these concepts, all you will ever have is 100 dead Al Dubbs. The reason why Al Dubb is a living part of Philippine pop culture today is because people reacted to it, are reacting to it, and may continue to react to it till the newer pop phenomenon comes along. Using the same logic, you could have 1,000 art reviews being written by 1,000 art critics in the country for dozens of art magazines, but if no one reacts to even just one of these art reviews, you'll have nothing but a dead art critical culture. Let me give our students here a reality bite for an example. A gallerist would hire a writer to write about his painter's next show. Now, would the gallerist read what the writer wrote? Would the artist? Would the people who go to that show read what's written on the wall or in the catalog? Would the buyers care what the critic wrote? Who can answer yes to all of these questions and quantify it? Or better yet, who can do a check on the quality of the reading if there was one? So you see, it's back to the Al Dubb secret. It doesn't matter that we have 1,000 art reviews manufactured every week. If no one reacts to any of them and all we have is an industry celebrating their mere presence, then the real picture is what we have now. Not a living art critical culture, but corpses of art criticism that the industry would like to pretend are living simply because they are there. In truth, what we have are art critical zombies looking for a readership to eat. To be honest, all we need is just one art review. Just one art review that a handful of people would react to for us to be able to say that we now have a socially living art critical culture as against an art critical culture living only in the individual reviewer's head. So, to end my 10-minute talk, let me say that what we're in dire need of is not really more art fairs or more art magazines, whose jobs are actually only to make judgments about an elephant the way blind men around an elephant make judgments about it. The art critics and even the art magazine editor's job is to get focus on their right things or their magazine's bias for or against things. Get focus on where they are located beside that elephant of art. We are not in dire need of their multiplication precisely because they have forever been giving us those invaluable services that they're so good at giving. But still, no one's been listening to what they've been saying about the elephant. Everybody just wants them to keep saying something, anything, and just be there for the sake of being there. Just be there, even if in truth the art community is deaf to what these blind men have to say. And so, instead of more art critics, I propose that our calls be redirected to our deeper need for art historians. Art historians who would record not only what's going on in the art production area of the industry at present, not only what's going on in the selling area of the industry, not only what's going on in the buying and art collecting area of the industry, but also what's going on in the art critical area of the industry. Remember, politicians don't react strongly to opinion columns and opinion pages, but they constantly react to news items' presentation of facts. Let's have contemporary art historians churn out essays of facts. Then maybe we'll find the art community reacting to their words with the shock of a possibly real outcome. That's my talk. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I must say, we have been treated to quite a number of talks that are ripe for discussion. They may seem, at first glance, three different subjects, but I will ask each speaker a question pertinent to his or her talk, and then I'm sure that all the subjects will eventually intersect. Okay, and that is, I think, that is because we share the same space in that sense, and no idea is always related to another idea. Okay, to Carlo Mar, I mentioned, first of all, just a biographical background. I mentioned a while ago that many critics come from a literary background. As you know, or as you may not know, Carlo Mar is a very accomplished poet, no? And I have read his poetry, and to my pleasant surprise that he has taken apart criticism. What Carlo Mar, what preparation in terms of studies brought you to criticism, and why art criticism?
First, it started for the real curiosity of the painting or the artwork itself. In the sense that I would always be on a personal basis, like going to a museum or going to a gallery, the kind of creativity and imagination and the process as well that came into the creation of the work. So basically, I was intrigued by that, as opposed compared that to how a writer produces or writes a poem. So something like that. Very experiential in the sense that I just like paintings generally, and then it helped also that I was writing in college for our school publication, The Varsitarian. So during that time, we were also exposed to like art exhibitions happening maski sa ano lang sa loob ng UST. From there, somehow it became a path to pursue, And there was Art Manila, I contributed to that, and then it ended, or gets to this point that, you know, I'm writing a regular column. So I would say it's really the impetus, it's really the experience of encountering artwork, the awe, the joy, something like that. I won't lie. So it's really that, it's not really the theory, the, you know, what it possibly may mean, but, you know, the kind of, you know, that the affect that is instigated once I look at the work of art.
Hello, Miss Silvana. Big hand for Miss Silvana. Dear Silvana. So, you know, Carlo Mara, I want to ask you a question that has always been asked at critics. Have you ever wanted to do an artwork yourself?
To be honest, never imagined myself to actually, because I think it's more like the thinking that it's a totally different process. I don't know, I just don't have the confidence, I guess, the chutzpah to really just go ahead and do it myself. That's the honest answer to that question. No.
Don't you think that someone who writes art criticism would be a better critic if he or she handled the brush himself?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Because the process as well, he would know, he would enter that, I don't know, zone of creation, contemplation that an artist experiences. But critics, like for instance, the critics that we respect here in the country, with your exception, they're not really practicing artists. I'm not aware whether they dabbled in art creation at some point in their lives, but I think it would help. Only in the on the stage of really getting into that zone, getting into the, you know, the hand on the canvas or sculpting or even the conceptualization. Definitely, I think that would be an ideal education for a writer who wants to write about art.
How do you choose which show to write about?
Okay, first it would be like, as I mentioned earlier, I'm really drawn to the paintings, figurative works and all of that. So I try to check out the exhibitions going on, and the one that most appealed to me, that's what I write about. And I want to say that this upfront that the intention really is not to provoke or to make statements or to interrogate, to use an art critical phrase, artwork. It's really to understand, to know the painting at some visceral level.
Thank you, Carloman. We move to Sam. Sam, the subject of the Puno has been, happened some years ago, huh?
Yes.
4 years ago?
Yes.
But the way you presented your case, it's like it's happening now. To what do you attribute that passion, that intense reaction, that the event still has a grip on you?
Wait, I'm not used to answering questions, I'm used to asking the questions, so this is quite a new role for me.
You know, Sam, as she said, she's a reporter, she's so used to asking like, well, the tables are turned.
I know, this is hard, I must say. Wait, so you're asking why people reacted so strongly to the exhibition? People or me?
No, you.
Me?
Yes.
It was the most reporting I did on an art exhibition in my life as a reporter. It was crazy. I was dealing with daily deadlines, you know? I mean, usually as an art reporter, I have the luxury of time. I can wait several weeks since the exhibition is up for a month. this time it was not like that. I mean, as the press conference finished, my editor was already asking me, they were treating it as a hard news story. And thank you for asking this question, because I must say that the business world threw its resources into covering this issue, because I wasn't the only one covering it. We had our Palace reporter behind it, we also had our Nation reporter behind it. So, yes, this is why, I mean, yeah, so that's why.
As I understand it, the Kulo was, prior to the CCP exhibition, was previously exhibited already at the Ateneo,
yes,
de Manila?
Correct, yes, I think in the Jesuit House?
Indeed, yes.
Yes, a version of it though. A version of it, it might have lacked the phallus. There was no phallus, thank you, Miss Silvana. Yeah, so it also appeared in a Stone Tree video as a background.
Yeah, yeah, because they were saying that it was shown at the Catholic University and there was no uproar about the work. So now you're saying it's because of the phallus that created
The phallus, and then it was Catholic, I mean, it was perceived to be attacking the Catholic faith, and as you know, I mean, we are a Catholic country, plus the remarks that Archbishop Cruz made to mass media, calling it sick, calling it sickening. You know, we have a feeling, my editor and I were talking about this, that if he had just stayed quiet, the exhibition could have closed. Yeah. Like just ran and closed when it was scheduled to close, because before that, I mean, you have to remember it opened what, early June, July. So there was that period of time where it was open and people had already seen it, already had written comments in the little logbook, and there was nothing there about blasphemy or sacrilege. So it was really the show of Ms. Webb and the remarks of Archbishop Cruz, I think, in my opinion.
Is it true that a great part of the uproar was the fact that it was covered by a national program like TV Patrol?
Yes, also. That also. I mean, it got a lot of coverage. That is true. It reached a wider audience. People who may not really be interested in art in the first place were exposed to these images. That for some could be disturbing. It challenged them, I guess, and you know, it caught the imagination of people.
Okay, this is what I mean by I want the questions to, the issues to intersect. I want to ask Carlo Mar, who says that, he is partial to figurative painting. What you have written about Kulo?
It's hypothetically.
So if your editor asks you, Carlo Mar, go and review that controversial show.
Oh, definitely. I never say no to your editor.
No, beyond obeisance to our editor. Are you shocked by the work? Are you taken by the work? Would you have written about it?
To be honest, the gestures, quote unquote, the shock tactic, it's been there. It's part of art history. I mean, the way it's presented, and other people say that the gesture was not even new. It's only because of the reaction of the people that really drew the firestorm around it. So,
may I just add to that? From a reporter point of view, for me, the story was the story, in how it just became this huge thing, which is a very rare occurrence for art.
Is this good for Philippine art?
Yes, I think so.
Okay.
Everyone was talking about it. Everyone had an opinion. Everyone wanted to see it. There was interest. It's not all the time that this happens to art. So for me, it was an exciting time as a journalist.
Thank you, sir. I want to intersect that answer with a talk by Mr. Jojo. Is this the kind of reaction that you're seeking?
Yes and no. Yes, because the reaction would lead to other reactions. And the ultimate reaction would be a classic. clarification of the codification use. Because what there was actually was an alienation of the public to a codification of an art. That people who were, it's like a realist painter commenting on abstract expressionism's not being art. You know, kahit anak ko, magagawa yan eh. Kahit yung kindergarten ko, anak magagawa. And it's born out of ignorance. It's a comment that would derive from a person, a fellow artist, but an artist who happens to be ignorant or have no knowledge whatsoever, perhaps, of the concerns of abstract expressionism or minimalism for that matter. It's like, you know, if I'm trying to buy the best death metal or rock music record of the year, and I seek advice from a jazz critic, I certainly am not going to get the right review, right, about the best death metal records, because to him, all the death metal records are just noise. They're all puns. It's the same with the relationship between the public's reaction to Medea Cruz, which happens to be an art thing. Now, we in the art world know that shop art is not shopping anymore. But the public who happens to be alienated to the codifications of the art. Because, you know, before you can appreciate an art, you have to know the elements of the art. Right? Before you can appreciate grunge rock, you have to know what grunge rock is all about. Otherwise, you have no business being there or commenting even, you know, except as an outsider commenting on a thing that people are so obsessed
with. What is your venue for disseminating your ideas and insights on art?
I used to blog. Actually, I defended Medea Cruz's work. I started talking about because there were discussions. I made a criticism of F. Shamil Hussain's criticism. When he said it wasn't art, I started saying, so who says what is art and what is not art? From what standpoint? If ugly art is art to a New Yorker, then ugly art is not art to a for us, maybe? Who's to say? And then I started talking also about because it was deemed as an attack on Christianity as a whole. And I started saying, what do the images really say? Because an iconism as well as, you know, the hatred for icons are part of Christian history. So an iconism is also a Christian act. So how can this be not a Christian art? That's practically this sort of my argument in my blog.
Jojo, let me ask you a question, or let me make you an offer on behalf of the editor of Inquirer Star. Would you like to write for a lordship?
Yeah, why not?
Thank you so much. I think many readers will benefit from your very from your other insights. I want to ask Sam, how has all this tremendous publicity?
Wait, before that, can I invite you in turn to contribute to discourse.com?
Okay, thank you so much. That's what we call hit for time. Sam, all this tremendous volume of publicity, don't you think it's a damage to the reputation of the artist? More negative than positive?
Can I just rely on a cliche and say that any publicity is publicity, not at the bottom? That's something to ask the artist. I'm not going to pretend to speak to him, for him.
Yeah, well, true, obviously the artist is the best person to answer.
But I know that he's retreated to the province, I think. Retreated, sorry, I used the wrong word. He's now in the province where it's there, it's quieter there, he no longer receives death threats.
No, precisely.
Yes, right after, yes.
Ms. Duamila exhibited right after that. But that's interesting that you use the word retreated. But you see, it's like you're like in the eye of a storm in the midst of a maelstrom. And this reminds me of the example of the scandalous, controversial instance in the case of the British Trinidadian artist Chris O'Feely, where he constructed the image of the Virgin Mary using elephant dung. And all this attendant goha, that when he lost his peace of mind and he retreated to Trinidad, I believe, his original home place. And now he's been interviewed and he's trying to recover his peace and his solitude, and he's doing good work. So is this the kind of attention that we need to give our artists, that the media makes a feast of them?
Let me think about that. Hold on. Is this the kind of attention that we want? The initial reports, no, that is not the kind of attention we want to give, to blow it up. I mean, as I said earlier, on the TV show, it was related to the RH bill, and Medeo, that wasn't what his work was about. So, you're not doing your job correctly. You're not reporting correctly. If you're misrepresenting an artist, I think.
Solomon, have you ever savaged an artist's show?
Not the word. No, never. Soon, I hope.
Hey, listen, guys, be ready with your questions because you're next. Can someone help us get questions from the audience? It's their turn now.
Hi, good afternoon. My question is, do you think there's space for polemics in broadsheets? I mean, in the sense that you think newspapers have a role to play in filtering good or bad art, whatever that may be.
This question is directed to
the public. Okay. Let me put it this way. The mere fact that, say, an exhibition gets a coverage, that would mean certain decisions were made, certain choices were made over and above other exhibitions that were happening during the same time. Why would they choose a certain event or a certain exhibition to cover over and above other exhibitions? I would say yes, it would be preference, but based on your question, that would just sound like ingenious. Because of course there are other aspects that come into choosing or selecting what gets coverage, like in terms of aside from preference, like perhaps the ideology, perhaps my awareness, my familiarity about the artist and his genre. I would also say my familiarity with the galleries. There may be galleries that I won't willfully avoid. No, I won't cover. That's not part of the thinking. But there would be galleries whose exhibitions I would check more than the others. That I think has proven upon the track record of consistently putting out good shows. That seems circuitous. In terms of polemics, like asking questions, interrogating the exhibitions. I would like to say it's not even like the art critics. I can't think of in my mind like someone who's directly or consciously antagonistic. Someone, it's really coming from the place of explaining it to the audience. Perhaps, that's why there's like a particular anxiety when the critic is abandoned to what I do, because criticism has that kind of connotation that you have to have the fans. But straight out, I would like to say that it's really about explaining, educating the audience, making relationships in terms of its present moment to its historical past. So it's not just merely saying it's good or bad. So there, I hope I answered your question.
My question is both for Carmar and Sam. So in the period that surrounded Kulo, the piece, the artwork itself, got lost, right? So I don't think I read a lot of descriptions about it. I don't think. My question is going there. No? Description in the sense that the reporter makes a judgment on the work, whether the texts that came about because of the work, I would think of them as maybe the afterlife of the work, which may spell either the death or the resurrection of an artist's career. As art journalists, if you feel comfortable with the label, the term, do you think it's important that an art journalist renders judgment on a work so that the work itself doesn't get lost in the, the pile of texts that would maybe we can look at them as the afterlife of peace?
Render judgment on a work. I don't do that. I'm not interested in what I think. That sounds so weird. But it's really putting the work front and center, because as you said, it gets lost. So what I want to do is to at least capture, what it looked like for people who would not be able to have seen it because it had already been closed. And for the descriptions to be vivid enough and to be clear enough that when you do indeed go there, you don't feel that you were duped into thinking that it was something else. You know what I mean? So you read the report, you go there to the exhibition and say, oh yes, it was a Mickey Mouse with Coke hand ears. Oh yes, there was a Red Fest. Okay, yes, these are things that you would really see in Quiapo. So there, for me, it's the accuracy and clarity. For me, that's what's important. It's not like passing judgment on the work. Yeah, and getting to hear the sides of the artist, of the curator, of the actual people who were involved. For me, their thoughts are more interesting than what I think of it. You know, they were the ones producing the work.
Yeah, I think the value judgment of, say, that artwork, as we saw Sam's like slide, like most or some of the names, I would say, like art columnists who are trained, I would say paid, but trained to offer judgment. We expect it from them. They may be coming from, different points of view. I saw Randy Levitt's name there. I saw, aside from Afshinil Hussain's name, and many others. So, as art writers, I don't know it. I'd be honest, judgment is no longer a fashionable thing to do when it comes to writing about art. I think judgment could be something else, not outright judgment in terms of the quality, formalistic or otherwise, of the work, but judgment in terms of first, the selection of what to cover, the judgment of who to talk to, what to highlight in your work. So more, less on in-your-face value judgment, but more on the little decisions on presenting an argument about the work. So really, it's more like presenting an argument over and above creating a value judgment.
Can I just add something that para may paingitan tayo? About the presence of polemics in broadsheets. I was talking to a gallerist late 2014, and he was telling me about the French landscape, a French art critical landscape, mainly Paris. And he was saying, in Paris, you pay an art reviewer in the newspaper to cover a show in your gallery. But when you pay him, you only pay him to review the art show. You don't pay him to review a positive art show. He can actually lambast the show all he wants, but you don't pay him to do a positive review. The being reviewed is an honor enough, and that's why galleries would pay reviewers, food reviewers, to visit their restaurants. Even if the food reviewer gives them a one-star review instead of a five-star one, it's honor enough that they were reviewed. So they paid for that, they didn't pay for it.
They pay for presents.
Right. I don't know which period he was talking about, but he is... I can mention his name though. Her name.
I don't believe if I pay anybody is going to write anything wrong against my gallery. I believe that the honesty there is that you go because it's an important show. But if I pay you, you're bought. There is no way.
Yeah,
reviewer, art people, the art critic groups, international groups, they will lose their critical membership to be part of the critic group if I can prove that you're wrong. You cannot do that automatically, no matter what she said. Of course, she's not going to tell you I can do it. So I personally never saw somebody that I pay somebody and he is going to write wrong.
I've never been to France, so I just took a
chance. Italy, German, whatever you're talking. We say human, you get paid, you get bought.
Well, like I said, the issues all intersected and actually fluidly moved into the next session, which is the gallery gallerists discussion later on. Beautiful. I want to thank Carlomar, Sam, and Giorgio for listening and boosting discussion. We take a 10-minute break, have coffee, 15, okay, Merienda's here, and come back resuscitated for the gallery discussion.